The absolute majority of flash memories are actually NAND flash memories rather than NOR flash memories. Now, NOR flash memories are sometimes used. They have specialty applications, which is when we need really fast memories, because as you know, NOR ROMs are faster than NAND ROMs. But because of the density of NAND ROMs, they are the architecture of choice when we implement flash. Understanding NAND ROMs is a little bit more complicated than understanding NOR ROMs because there's a bunch of complications along the way. The first is that for NAND arrays, we have cells that contain transistors and cells that do not contain transistors. But unlike NOR arrays, the cells that do not contain transistors do not contain open circuits instead of the transistors. They contain short circuits. So in other words, if this specific transistor, for example, was to be erased or programmed or whatever, then we need a short circuit instead of an open circuit here. We need this transistor to have a short circuit. We need it to be always on, which is why when we have NAND ROMs, these are the two characteristics we switch between. So characteristic A is the default characteristic, and characteristic B is the one we program into. And so what's going to happen here is that we are going to create a depletion mode transistor in characteristic B, and this transistor is on even at VGS equal to zero, which means that for most intents and purposes, it is a short circuit while we are reading from the array. And when we say erasure, we mean we are going back from characteristic B to characteristic A. And so for NOR ROMs, for NOR arrays, the characteristic B was actually higher than the supply voltage, but here characteristic B is going to have a threshold voltage that is lower than ground, making the transistor always on, making it act as a sort of a short circuit. Of course, it's not going to be a short circuit, a perfect short circuit. It's going to have a finite channel resistance, but that's okay. Now, this is the architecture of a NAND flash array. And what's happening for the NAND flash array is that we have units. Each column is called a unit. And now, in NAND flash memories, the units or the columns are usually really short because NAND ROMs suffer from high delay. And the high delay happens because the resistance of the series connection of MOSFETs grows really quickly. And so one way to deal with this is to keep these units of series transistors short. So we're talking not about three transistors, of course, this is an illustrative case, but we are talking about maybe 16 or 32 or 64 transistors at most. What we're going to find also is that when we do erasure, we cannot erase a certain cell, which is what we expect from flash. But what's going to happen is that we will have to erase an entire column, which again motivates keeping the columns rather limited in size. One smart thing to do is to have the column be the same size as the word size of the processor we are implementing. So if you have a 64-bit processor, maybe the word is going to be 64 bits, because usually you don't actually need to erase a single bit, you need to erase an entire word. So in that case, the fact that flash erases entire chunks of data is going to be fine. So group of bits here is characterized by the presence of these two pass transistors, which are two NMOS transistors at the bottom and at the top. And they have enable signals fed to them. And the enable signals are common to the two transistors. So they are either on together or cut off together. So let's look at how we can move the transistors between characteristics A and B. So in this case, we are targeting cell 10, this specific cell. So we apply grounds to the two terminals on the top and the bottom. And we also apply VDD to the pass transistors, to these two pass transistors, and VDDs to all the intermediate gates of all the intermediate transistors. This allows the ground to pass so that the target cell is now going to have the following characteristics: 0 volt on the drain, 0 volt on the source, and VPP on the gate. This is going to cause tunneling, and the field is going to be in the direction into the substrate, causing electrons to be attracted into the floating gate. This is going to cause electrons to accumulate into the floating gate, causing the transistor to move into characteristic A. Notice that what's going to happen here is that we are not going to cause the transistor to disappear. In fact, we are going to cause the transistor to behave as a transistor. So we are assuming that the default case here is that the transistor acts as a short circuit where it is conducting all the time. And we want to create a transistor that is not a short circuit. So we attract the extra electrons, the implanted electrons, the depletion mode electrons from the substrate into the floating gate. Now, is this not going to affect the other cells in the row and the other cells in the column, which is something we always have to check? The answer is no, because if you look at any other cell in the column, the terminal voltages are 0 volt, 0 volt, and VDD. These are not voltages that can cause tunneling. These are voltages that are used normally for reading. So we are safe. For the other columns, this is also safe enough, because when you have VPP applied here, you're going to have VPP on the gate of this transistor, which exposes you to the possibility of tunneling into this transistor. But what we're going to do here is that we're going to apply VPP also at the sources and the drains of all of these transistors, causing VPP to appear on all the terminals of this transistor and thus saving it from tunneling. So nobody else is going to tunnel, nobody else is going to program along the way of this transistor. On the other hand, when we go to do erasure, and again here we want to erase cell 10, so we apply the shown terminal voltages. The pass transistors are all passing the VPP, so that we end up with the following terminal voltages. Now, these terminal voltages are going to create a large electric field, vertical electric field, but this electric field favors the flow of electrons from the floating gate into the substrate. So they will cause electrons to flow back into the substrate of the storage transistor, causing the formation of an implanted channel and causing this transistor to appear as an effective short circuit. The problem here is that all the other transistors in the same column are also going to erase at the same time, because they observe voltages that expose them to tunneling. So this transistor, for example, observes a VPP and a VDD, which exposes it to tunneling, and therefore the value stored here is going to change. Specifically, what's going to happen here is that the threshold voltages of these other transistors are going to switch. But the problem is that the amount of deviation in the threshold voltages of these transistors is going to be different from the amount of deviation in the threshold voltage of the target transistor. So it's even worse than the NOR flash ROM, where the values stored are all erased. This is not even that. This is the fact that every single transistor is going to have a different threshold voltage now. So when we erase, when we want to erase here, what we're going to do is actually we're going to reset the entire column. So what we're going to do is we're going to write ones into all the cells first, and then we are going to erase them all next. So we're going to write into this cell, and every single cell in the column, and then we are going to erase them all in one fell swoop and then get rid of all of their values. So you cannot actually erase a specific bit, and it also takes a lot of time to erase it, because you first have to program all of them. This allows you to start from a point where all of them have the same threshold voltage. So when you expose them to tunneling, they will all end up at the same point with the same threshold voltage as well.